So, are we ready to roll? We're going. Okay. Welcome, everybody, to another episode of From the Valley. This is Mark Oakley here, your happy host and part-time cartoonist and part-time podcaster and full-time human, I guess. And today we have, this is really cool, we have a great guest on. His name is Will Cooper, and he's another visual artist. You'd think I'd have more visual artists on, but I've had musicians, and I've had, sort of ex-army guys, and I've had, circus people, all kinds of neat people. This is the first time I get to talk to another person who's in the graphic arts. So how are you, Will?
I'm great, thanks. How are you?
It's been a long night. This is the first time we've done one of these things early in the morning, right? Like Zeus is like, yeah, he's booked for 9. I was like, 9? That's like 9 in like sun coming up 9? Or so, yeah. So, and then I was up all last night tinkering with the audio stuff. So we've got some cool new solutions on the board. Anyway, just background tech stuff, which I enjoy. But I right away, I want to show off some of your cool artwork just so that people go, oh, I know that guy. Cause when I saw it, I was like, right, I know his stuff. So maybe you can describe a little bit about, let's see. There you go. What form your artwork takes? Like, what do you do?
Well, it's a little bit hard to describe. People when they look at it, the first thing they often say is, "Oh, it's a puzzle." Mm. I don't think that there's another art form that it fits into. Have you heard of intarsia?
No.
Okay, well that's probably the closest thing to what I do. Intarsia is where you cut pieces of wood, usually mm-hmm. with a scroll saw. It's usually different thicknesses of wood and different types of wood, and then you glue them together to create. Usually, it's something that you'd hang on a wall, but what I do is a bit different in that it's really more. I take one sheet of plywood, uh-huh. and I seal it or prime it, and then I draw a sketch. I project a sketch that I've drawn onto the plywood, trace it, then cut along all the lines with a scroll saw.
Okay.
To get a whole bunch of pieces, and some of these, some of the designs are really detailed. So there'll be it's quite tricky getting some of the cuts, and then I. I sand the edges of each piece, which is the most time-consuming part of the process, to get really nice, smooth, curving
beautiful
lines.
Beautiful, smooth edges that make them look like toy pieces. Almost.
That's right. So, and then I paint them, and I put lots of coats of like artist acrylics on each piece, and then I put an isolation coat over the paint once it's fully cured, and varnish it, and then glue all the pieces back together. It takes a while to make each artwork, and some of the bigger artworks can take me up to a month to make.
Whoa. I mean, sanding is one of those jobs that's like your shoulders hurt after, man. It's not
neckers.
Do you use a machine at all for any of this, or is it all hand done
for the bigger pieces? I'll start with an orbital sander just to take take some of the edge off.
Yeah.
But I always finish even on the bigger pieces with sanding by hand, just to get a really smooth edge. And for the smaller pieces, of course, I can't use an orbital sander for. Right. In fact, I often use a magnifying glass to see that, like a pupil of an eye or something like that, to sand the edges and
just get them perfect, right?
Yeah.
Wow. Because I mean, I love your stuff. I remember when I first saw it, I probably had the same reaction everyone else. It's like, that's cool or gorgeous. And your first thought is you reach out, you want to play with it. Yeah. You go, wait, hang on. This is hanging on a wall. I'm an adult.
I have a show right now at Jack's Gallery in Wolfville.
Oh, right on.
And under each piece, there's a sign that says, please do not touch. Because that's what everyone wants to do, especially kids. They want to touch the pieces. And it's all right. I mean, like I said, there's a lot of varnish protecting the pieces. But it's not good to get jam or grubby fingers on.
You know what though? It's like if your artwork can engage people to the point where they're reaching out to you know, have a tactile experience with it. That's pretty amazing. Like, I mean, there's a lot of paintings, a lot of things, like a lot of, we're so spoiled in terms of artwork these days. There's images are cheap to make. You can print them out. They look amazing. We're surrounded by it. And you can sort of walk past it in a haze. But if you're sort of confronted with a piece of artwork and your first impulse is you want to play with it, that must be pretty gratifying, man. That's, I'm going to ask the question because I'm sure you've been asked before. Have you ever considered making puzzle pieces, puzzle things for kids?
Because it takes so long to make one of these things, I could do that, but it would, if I was charging anything for my time, it would be one expensive puzzle. You know, so
what does it cost to get one of your pieces?
I've started charging enough now that I can make a living doing what I'm doing. So they range in price from about the smallest pieces are 1 foot by 1 foot, so 12 inches square, and they're $600.
Okay.
And my most expensive piece to date was $3,000.
All right. And the ones I've seen are sort of as big as this tabletop. And I noticed your subject matter is also, it's not just the way it's made. There's a particular subject matter that you seem to pursue. And I was, it seems to be like Nova Scotian in character and in mood.
Yeah, I don't know why I started making that type of art. I think I've always loved the ocean and, loved Nova Scotia. And maybe it could be that I was influenced by, local folk artists.
Yeah.
But I think just for whatever reason, that's what I'm drawn to, the kind of art that I like.
Yeah.
So I make what I like, and I'm inspired by the ocean. I'm inspired by nature. I often do animals.
Okay.
And I've always, I've always been very into nature. Even as a young kid, I spent all my spare time in the woods with my dog, just exploring. And I think that's.
Did you go to art school?
I recently did 1 year in New Zealand studying illustration and design.
Okay.
But that was after I'd started my career as an
good
artist.
I mean, that's, I know a lot of young people who've gone to art school, and there's something strange about art school. It's like, you can take, I'm going to take engineering, or you can take, journalism, or you can study all these things, or you can go to art school, and it's a 3-year course. And when you are done, you will be an artist. And I don't know if that's where the arts began. There was no university to go. It seems out of sync with what art should be. And then when I see some of the, it seems like a confused, anti-natural way of approaching it. Whereas, tell me about the first piece that you made that kind of tipped you into this particular style.
Sure. So it kind of happened by accident. I'd never planned to be a professional artist, although if that had been a choice, I might have gone for it. If someone had said you can choose what you want to do with your life, I might have done that. But I was working as an electrician, and this is after having returned the first time from New Zealand. My wife and I spent most of our adult lives going back and forth between New Zealand and Nova Scotia, trying to decide where we wanted to put down roots.
Right.
But we have put down roots now in Nova Scotia. At the time when I was working as an electrician, we'd just come back from a 6-year stint in New Zealand, where I'd been working as an environmental studies lecturer. I had a pretty sweet job there, even though I'm not qualified to do anything like that here. It was a job that I just...
Oh, right. It's national, isn't it? Yeah.
I lucked into it in New Zealand. And when we came back to Nova Scotia, I wasn't able to find a job teaching or doing anything like what I was doing in New Zealand. So wanting to support my family, I thought I should get into the trades. I've always been handy and enjoyed fixing up houses. And I decided to become an electrician. So I did that for a year, and while I enjoyed it, I enjoyed a lot about it. There was nothing creative. There's nothing intellectual about about doing electrical work or creative about doing electrical work. It's very kind of...
If you don't follow the rules, you burn someone's house down.
That's right. Yeah. So I wasn't happy. And in my spare time, I needed to have a creative outlet. So do you know Hope for Wildlife in on Eastern Shore?
No.
I think it's the only wildlife rescue center in Nova Scotia.
Oh, I think I heard of this one. Yes.
Right. Well, my wife and I are friends with Hope, who runs the sanctuary. And
yes, I absolutely have heard of
that. Yeah. She has a TV show, and it's a pretty big deal in that area. But I wanted to make something to donate to her sanctuary to sell at her shop and, you know, raise some money to help the animals. And I had this idea to do, and I don't know where it came from, but I just imagined this wooden painted fox glued onto a black backboard. And I told my wife, Jen, about it, and she thought it sounded hokey. Uh-huh. And, you know, kind of like she suggested that I not do it. But I did it anyway, and it turned out pretty well. And, you know, my wife liked it, and I donated it to Hope. And then I made a seal, which... people were, you know, responded very well to. People were encouraging me to make more of this stuff. And
what did it look like? Do we have an image of that, Zeus?
The seal, I don't think, is on my earliest piece would be the owl.
Okay.
There's an owl on my website, which was, I think, the fourth piece that I made.
And was it in the same style, or was it just the animal and on a background, or is it?
It changed a little bit. When I started out, I used 3/4 inch laminated pine.
Okay.
And now I use plywood. Mm-hmm. It's thinner, so that makes the artwork.
Do you work lighter. Like 1/4 inch ply or?
I use there are two boards. The back board that I glue it to is 1/2 inch, and I use 1/4 inch for the part that I cut.
So
that I cut
you're out. Not killing your man. Can you imagine going through 1/2 inch plywood for each piece?
Yeah. Like go through a lot of blades.
Yeah, you know.
But yeah, so then I started doing landscapes, and really it was my my wife's family initially that bought my first few pieces, and then you know, people in the community. I did a show at the Wolfville Library.
Okay.
And then my second show, I think, was at Jack's Gallery, and people were buying my work, and I started going to art shows around the province. And I went to, for example, the folk art festival.
Yep.
In Lunenburg, and I did very well there. And I had a lot of support from the local art community. It just evolved naturally, which, as you say, is how it ideally should happen, rather than having to go through the traditional art school.
I feel like the tradition, I have negative thoughts about the traditional arts system, and we can talk about that later, but right now I just want to focus on, so how long ago did you begin?
It was 2013.
So you've been at it for a very short time, only 7 years, right?
And I did take a couple of years out, went back to New Zealand to, as I said, to study art and creative writing. I did 1 year of visual art and 1 year of creative writing.
I mean, there's something to be said for that. I mean, I did a year of illustration college in Ontario, and it was kind of like learning how to be an electrician. There is a lot of technical stuff.
Yeah.
And I loved that. I was like, oh, you know, how do you use this kind of tool? I was learning about all, because, you know, you go into an art store and you pick up an object, like, the heck is this? What's it for, you know? And one of the things I like to do is, like, I buy a weird looking thing and take it to one of the teachers. What is this? Like, oh, that's a such and such. Here's how you use it. And you can go play with it. And it was like expanding your toolkit, and then you could, and I had no interest in, here's your project. Yeah. I got my own stuff I want to do. And I, you know, I made like I illustrated a little children's book kind of thing just on my own. It wasn't for a class, but it did fire me up, and I learned a lot, but I don't even, I think I just walked away. I stopped going to classes, and I was like 19. I didn't really understand how the whole, it was just like bureaucracy with paintbrushes. And it just didn't stick with me. Right. So you took a year of illustration. Like, what made you decide that you wanted to learn a little bit more about illustration?
It was a program that I had been interested in. I'd wanted to take it when we lived in New Zealand before, but we just had our first child, and I was worried about making money, and I thought I should do something more practical. So I went to teacher's college instead.
Okay.
But this time when we decided to go back to New Zealand, Again, we were confused about where we wanted to be at this point still. I just wanted to do what I wanted to do. I'm going to take a chance and study what I want to study, which is why I did art for 1 year. And I did learn a lot.
Yeah.
You know,
was it sort of art history or was it?
No, it was illustration and design.
Okay.
And also using technology like Photoshop to help with to create art, which I find immensely useful now. Like prior to learning how to use Photoshop, I would I'd make a piece of art. I'd do my sketch. I'd cut out the artwork, and then I would paint it. Often, only to be unhappy with the colors and paint it again, and still be unhappy with the colors and repaint all the pieces again. Sometimes I'd have an artwork sitting on a table for, you know, a month, and not be happy with it. In fact, I still have one that I was never happy with, which I should probably finish one of these days. But what I do now is I do my sketch, and then I scan it, put it into Photoshop, and I color it in. And I make sure I'm happy with the colors before I invest all that time into cutting it out and painting it. And that works much better for me.
Because like there's a real speed benefit to digital stuff. You can just go tap and green, no, blue, no, purple. Yeah. And it's that quick as opposed to mixing the right purple. And then you realize, well, that was dumb. Yeah. Purple's the wrong color. Yeah. Should be green, you know? But the thing that's so nice about just from what you're describing is that there's also a real hands-on quality. When I was doing comics, when I first started, there was no photo. Well, there was Photoshop. I said, you should get Photoshop. Don't you need a really big, good computer to do that? I don't have to have one of those. And so I did everything by hand, and there were the text sections, which I would print out and then stick down with glue. And it was all, and it took an enormous amount of, sweat.
Yeah.
And blood, because there's lots of X-Acto knife work as well, and you know you're really sleepy, you cut yourself, and man, I bled on my artwork. But now it's 100% digital. I have a big digital drafting board, and it's like the detail. It's fast. It's wonderful, and there's something about it that's missing. Like I feel like I've sold like 10% of my soul got sold.
I get that. Yeah. I do get that. You know when. Using some of the tricks that that I used to have to use before Photoshop, like if you want to trace something, for example, you have to use your light table. I feel like when you're on the computer, it doesn't feel as natural, and I think maybe you lose some of the creativity when you're doing that. Maybe just because it doesn't feel so natural, I feel like I'm not in that same creative mindset as I am when I'm using my hands and I'm away from the computer. But at the same time, if there is something that you want to do, like take part of an image and blow it up or move it around to another part of the page, you don't have to spend all that time tracing it in a different, like, or tracing a whole new sketch, it makes it a lot easier to experiment. But yes, you do lose something, and
I feel like
part of it is the creativity.
I feel like as long as you balance it, because, I mean, there was this interesting period where I was like, okay, I was thinking about it. Oh, do I go digital? And I was like, I'm not going to go digital. I'm going to continue shipping my artwork to the printing plant, and that's going to be how it goes. I don't want any scanners involved. So I was, you know, staying very, very true to it. And then it turned out they fired their photographer, because what they used to do is take the pages and they'd shoot a big one-to-one piece of, film, big sheets of film, or one-to-one, two-to-one, whatever. And so it was an analog process all the way to the reader. It was the ink would, you know, and they got rid of that guy. He's like, well, it's just inconvenient. We scan it now. I was like, you do? And I was like, and your scans aren't as good as, if I get a scanner, then I can at least do it to my specifications and make sure that it looks good. And then it's just like, you know, I've had a few nights where it's like you package up all your artwork in a FedEx box and you're going, I just spent 2 months. There's I don't even want to think about what would happen if this got bent or dropped in a puddle or whatever, and you send it off and you insure the hell out of it, and it's just off it goes. And if it's a little late, you're like, you know, now you just hit send and it's totally safe. There's almost, I think there's, you know, they say artists have to suffer. And I think it's true of all powerful learning, is that if it's worthwhile, it hurts a little bit or a lot.
It takes a long time too.
You know, time and pain, you know, and by removing the time and the pain, suddenly you lower the bar, everyone can get in. And so who's special and or not, who's earned, who's really, really committed, who's the actual artist who just, this is their life, and who's it someone just like, you know, a dalliance or someone just, it's easy, it's, this is a hobby, I'm just gonna.
I think that's one of the things that people appreciate about my art, is that when they look at it, they can appreciate how long it must have taken to make each artwork. And then I can describe the process to people. And
you can't hit print with yours. You have to get some sandpaper out, man.
Really, and you can't. And honestly, like I'll spend days and days just doing nothing but sanding, you know, which at sometimes I struggle with, you know, but recently I bought some Bluetooth headphones.
Oh yeah.
So now I can listen to podcasts or music or the news, and it's kind of like meditation. I look at it as like just kind of, you know, zoning out, and it's a privilege, you know, to be able to do that for a living. It's not a very stressful job.
No.
But it's very time consuming.
Yes. Yeah, it's another thing that comes to mind when I look at your work is, how do I even get into this? I think you're a real artist just from the way you describe it. Do you know David Francie? Have you heard that name before?
He's
a musician. Okay. And he was a construction guy, and he even looks a little bit like you, but he got into music, and he's now a very successful musician. But it was just, he liked playing guitar, and he would be at the kitchen party, and but he was in construction. That was his life. And he just lived sort of a hard life, lifting bricks and all this, and just happened to be very good at playing the guitar. And he would sing songs about basically, you know, hard labor and blue collar living. And they're beautiful songs. And his friends were like, you should go to a club. I don't want to go to an open mic. I'm a construction guy. But his career pulled him in, and it was a very genuine, organic progression from where he began to this, like, he can fill stadium. I don't know about stadiums, but when he came through town, it was a packed theater. Yeah. Everyone loved him. And it was,
that's nice.
And he's a Maritimer as well. I don't know if I think he's Cape Breton. I couldn't say for sure, but there's something very genuine about finding your way into the artwork as opposed to deciding that you're going to do it through a bureaucratic method. And the other thing I really, really, really appreciate about your work is how beautiful it is. It's pleasing and pleasurable. Like, you look at one of your pictures and you can't help but feel better.
That's,
you know,
good. That's what I'm going for.
You know, and I think, and I know that when I was taking art classes in high school, and it's so, I don't think we should do this, but we've all, you know, old adults are like, oh, I had this one teacher and he told me this bad thing and I still hold a grudge. We've all had sort of positive and negative teaching experiences, but I do remember I was trying to draw beautiful things and it was poo-pooed. It was like, oh no, that's not art.
Yeah. I remember that happened to me at art school too, you know? The teachers all had their opinions about what art was, and I think being told how to make art or having those constraints, well, maybe it's good, maybe it can challenge you to grow as an artist. I didn't like it, despite having these teachers who would, you know, take apart things that I had made and maybe, you know, not like this aspect of this sketch that I'd done or something that I'd made on Photoshop. When I showed them my website and what I'd been doing in Nova Scotia, they all loved it. You know, they loved what I was doing, despite the fact that I'd never thought about critically about my art before. Mm. It's just something that I did intuitively. So, I think everyone has art can make art. You know, everyone's an artist, really. It's just something that you have to develop. And some people are more naturally drawn to develop that part of themselves than others.
How would you define art? That's a hell of a question, but yeah. Have you put some thought into that ever? Or? I'm always curious what artists say.
I think that, you know, there are all different kinds of art, right? You know, writing is art, music is art, there's visual art, storytelling in any form is art. If you want to get philosophical, then I could say that, you know, we're all making art all the time, and that we're creating our lives. You know, whether or not we're conscious of that, we're every day we're telling ourselves stories about what reality is and isn't, and telling each other stories about what reality is and isn't, and through telling those stories we're creating our reality, and we're contributing to creating this intersubjective reality that we all live in. I don't know if that's the answer you wanted, but that is going a little, taking it a little bit, maybe getting too philosophical.
Well, I'm not looking for any specific answer. Okay. I'm just like, when you ask that question, it requires some real puzzling. You got to sort of go, you know, what does it mean to be an artist? What is it? I like that answer. Like, we're just by living, like, but every choice you make.
But I think an artist, the difference between someone who is or isn't an artist is that an artist is someone who makes, who is creative, you know, who chooses to do things their own way, whether it's just even just seeing the world how they want to see it, rather than just blindly following what other people tell them. Someone who makes a conscious effort to create, whether it's you know, just through the stories that you tell, like the way that you see the world, or through painting pictures, or making music, or anything else.
It's let's see now. I would say that you can be aware of your behavior and be actively choosing, like, do I pick red or green? Do I go left or right? Do I buy a hamburger? Do I take a bag lunch? And you can automatically, you can just sort of follow a routine, and you can even make choices that are based on sort of automatic behaviors. Yeah. You can really stop and think. And I think when you're fully sort of like, okay, am I consciously making a choice here? Now you're waking up a little bit. You're not just an automatic little machine.
Yeah.
And in making that choice, well, why are you making that choice? Like, what is it that you're tapping into that's saying, nah, red, you know? Or it's that seems to be a part of it. I mean, I had an interesting conversation years and years and years ago. I was just going to launch a comic book company. I was still talking about it and putting artwork together. And I ran into a fellow on a subway train. I don't know where I met him. Anyway, you get into this conversation, and he was also a young man. Like, he might have been 19 or 20. And so when you're that age, you don't realize you're being rude or stupid or whatever. I said, yeah, I'm an artist. And he goes, oh, no, you're not an artist. You know, I said, really? He goes, no, you're a craftsman. Oh. And I said, well, what's the difference? He goes, oh, and he had this big, I said, and it was in, he had an interesting tale. He was living in a house. I guess he was, you know, had roommates, and all of his roommates were going to U of T. You're all university students, but not him. He just had a job somewhere, but he probably appreciated university more than them because he wasn't in it. I don't know why, what his reasons were. Maybe couldn't afford it. Maybe just, you know, didn't pass whatever tests were necessary, but he was soaking it in. And for him, there was probably like an ego element of it too, like a hierarchy of like, well, you know, these guys are smarter than me, and he doesn't want to feel that way. So when he meets someone like me and it's, oh, I'm an artist. Oh, no. There is a hierarchy, and you don't belong. Artist is up here and craftsman's down here. And I was angry. And I went home thinking, well, maybe I am a craftsman. Maybe what's the difference? What is art? How do you? And then it doesn't really, well, whatever, I'll put that aside because I have to draw this picture.
Yeah.
And then you're in, and you've got to sand the next piece, and you've got to make the next. And I think it's the inevitability of engaging with something that you see. And you mentioned it too, like the very first piece you made, that was it, the fox, was it? Or you saw it in your mind's eye. I've had that feeling. That's what it's where the best art comes from, is you can sort of see, oh, you know, like if I take,
try this out.
You know, yeah, and I, yeah. It's in your head and you go, that would look so cool. And yeah. I have to bring it into being. And there's something of yeah. art in that process.
And that happens to me a lot. Often when I'm out for a walk, you know, I'll see an image, I'll see a piece of art that I want to make. And then, but it almost always changes, you know, I'll do a sketch and develop it further. But yeah, it's
well, the dream image cannot be captured in two dimensions because it's always, it moves or has yeah. qualities to it. So I find like I'll see something in the mind's eye and I know I'm older now and I've reconciled that yeah. it will never look as cool as the thing in my mind.
Yeah.
It's my skills have been brought up and sometimes you come up with something that's, you know, it takes on its own life, but the thing that starts it is a living image. It's a yeah. living experience. Are you a photographer?
Not really.
No. So all the images that you come up with are there, you don't walk around with a camera and take a picture of the bay.
Sometimes I'll take a picture of something if I think it looks cool and I might want to make a painting out of it. But, generally I'll remember it. And, you know, my art's pretty loose, you know, it's not,
they look like dreamscapes. Yeah. You know? Yeah.
I think it's very realistic. It's,
I think
it's,
that's wonderful. It's, one of the things that Photoshop allows me to do is like, okay, I'll walk one of the, I mean, this one particular comic strip that I do is set in Wolfville. And so I get to draw backgrounds. And when I'm at my best, I can walk around and look at the church or look at the cafe and I can do a sketch mm-hmm. and I can sort of draw it from memory. And it takes a lot more work than just taking a camera shot and then take that, drop it into Photoshop,
yeah.
trace over the lines. And it's not as easy as it sounds. Like anyone thinks that you're cheating.
No, that is an art. That's an art form right there.
You're not cheating.
Yeah.
But you are also adhering very closely to the material world. So it looks like all the lines have correct angles yeah. of perspective, et cetera. The pictures that I do that people respond the most powerfully to are when I can't get a photograph of it or I can't get into that person's living room. So I have to do it from memory.
Yeah.
And it's always wrong. When I compare it, I'm like, man, these things aren't even exact at all.
But it doesn't matter.
The dream image, people instantly recognize it because I think they have a similar subconscious dream image as well. Yeah. It doesn't match up with the reality. And so you're sort of cutting out the material and directly communicating with
but
people.
But it's also maybe people appreciate that you're playing with reality, right? And that's what that's what we need to do. I mean, that's what an artist is, someone who doesn't just reflect things exactly as they see them, but who plays around with what they see and creates, helps to create new, brighter, happier worlds. Or
well, there's an emotional quotient as well. Like when I see a picture that you've done, I was like, some of the ones that really stand out are the ones where it's like, okay, you're looking at a body of water and there's some land behind it and little houses and trees and you're going, yeah, we've all seen that. Mm-hmm. But the one that exact image doesn't exist anywhere in reality, but we've all experienced it. And the feelings that come through it are, like if you were to take a photograph, you'd have to generate the feelings by looking at the photograph. Here, it's like mostly feelings. Mm-hmm. You're kind of getting a truer connection to the subconscious or to the dream.
Yeah, more condensed.
Yeah, it's like poetry, right? Yeah. I was having a conversation with a friend of mine a few interviews ago, and she's like, I love poetry. She's like, it took me a long time to get there. But the story that I had heard from someone was like, oh no, poetry is like, it's a type of compression. So what do you mean? I said, well, you can say in 5 or 6 words, you can capture an enormous amount of feeling and emotion. So you don't have to write 2 paragraphs to get all this. You can just do it in 5 words. And it was a way of saving paper.
Yeah.
Like you could remember it. And so someone could just give you the zip file version of the expanded, full image. And yeah. So with one of your visuals, I think you're getting a lot more information than just the straight visual.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well,
man. So how many pieces have you made in 7 years?
Oh, my wife counted them recently and told me, but I don't remember the exact number. I'd say less than 100.
Oh, is that right?
But okay. But close to 100.
Well, if it can take you up to a month for a big yeah. piece, then you're looking at
Yeah, I can't just whip up a painting in a couple of days or anything. It's a long process.
And I'm glad to hear you're charging suitable. I mean, for a one by one piece, $600 for, yes. Like, I met a guy at a farmer's market, and it was really neat. Like, you know, there's chickens and carrots and produce being sold, and there's me with my comic books, and there was this artist who set up, and he was doing fantasy, like dragons and swords and sorcery stuff. And he did really, really well. And he would make, you know, a couple $1,000 per market wherever he went. Wow. It was pretty cool.
Yeah.
And it was funny because when I had a really good day, oh, I made $400. That's like so great. I didn't want to make him feel bad. Yeah, I made four. And he was like, oh yeah, that's good for you. He says, I don't feel happy unless I've made $1,200.
Right.
You know, and then anything above that is gravy. I was like, really? And I was like, okay, clearly I'm talking to someone who knows how this works. Yeah. I asked him how he did it. And for him, it was like low cost, high volume. So he was a speed painter.
Right.
And he could do a big dragon scene. It would take him a couple days to, so he could pound out 10 or 20 paintings a month. And someone would be big, someone would be small. And they were good. They were very competent. They looked good. They were appealing to the eye. And I'm sure if he would slow down and spend a full month, I bet it would be just startlingly good, right? But that wasn't the business he was in. He was in keep your van full of paintings, and you have every weekend you have a different market. He had a whole routine set up. It looked exhausting, but his wife was very happy. His wife and daughter were there, and she was sitting to the side knitting, I think, and just had this sort of very content smile on her face. Going, oh, there's a woman who's very happy. She feels well taken care of, and her husband's out there selling artwork, and it was just like, that's a nice little family. He's got that figured out, right? But I don't think he was selling small pieces for $600. He was selling, you know, I think a big piece would be $400 or something like that.
Yeah, but he'd be selling quite a few of them.
Several, yeah. And that's the thing, is they're affordable. When you're in Nova Scotia, people are like, oh, $600.
Yeah, and that is one of the problems with my art is that because it takes me so long and I have to charge for it, most people, myself included, can't afford to, you know, to pay that kind of money for somebody to hang on their wall. But I do. I also do prints.
Yes.
So I have photographs taken of my artwork, and then have them have prints made in Halifax at Image House, and they're beautiful too, and a lot of people.
I've got to have buy to, those. Gonna have to get
buy those
to
put on those. Their walls.
I think it's great that artwork is price tagged at what it's actually worth. Like I think it's really important to do that. I think a lot of artists, when it comes to the money question, they just fold. They hate it. They don't want to think about it.
I hate it too. You know, and really, if it wasn't for my wife, then I wouldn't be able to. I couldn't be a professional artist.
Yeah.
You know, she's the level-headed.
She's your manager, man.
Yeah, she is my manager. And she does a good job. You know, she manages my Facebook, and she, you know, tells me what art shows to go to, and she helps me price the work and organizes me.
Oh, I'm glad to hear that as well.
And she's also she's the one who's organized getting this building, which isn't, but I was telling you about it earlier, it hasn't been built yet, but I'll soon have a gallery and workshop on our property where people can come and see my work all in one place, and see me at work perhaps too.
Wow, where is that going to be?
And just outside of Canning,
okay,
in the valley here.
Oh, so, man, Canning's getting a gift. That's great. And those exist all around Nova Scotia. You'll sort of drive around and you'll go, oh, here's a neat little spot where someone, you know, puts out his photography or sculptures or whatever. And that's, man, Nova Scotia has a really interesting approach to art. I don't know if, I haven't really thought about it. Like, I haven't driven through Ontario and looked for similar examples of people who are, do you know anything about that? You must rub shoulders with a lot of people kind of in your profession.
I'm sorry, there must be.
You must rub shoulders with other people who are kind of doing a similar thing to you.
Yeah, I mean, Nova Scotia certainly has a lot. I don't know about Ontario. Mm. I was planning to go there this summer, but COVID got in the way.
Yeah.
And actually, I had a lot of things planned for this summer, a lot of shows canceled. But there are lots of artists in the area around Nova Scotia and the Maritimes. And it just seemed to be a very, it's a place that I think attracts artists and people who want to kind of live that, that slower pace of life and a more affordable.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful, inspiring place to live and make art too. So maybe that's part of it.
Huh. It's funny because I mean I do a little bit of like you know in one of my comic strips I was saying I use backgrounds from this town that I'm in, but I will regularly have people, Mark, you should go out and do pictures of lobster traps and do pictures of the little bays with the fishing boats coming in. Oh, I like that kind of stuff, but yeah. I'm a storyteller.
Yeah.
Mark, you can make so much more money if you focused on making beautiful images that like,
this is one of the problems I have too. Now, I also want to say something. I actually have a lot to,
interesting.
To say, and, but I have to balance, when I'm making art, I have to think about, my wife helps me with this too. She'll often, if I tell her about an idea I have where there's a piece of art that I want to make that's going to have a message, she'll say, maybe when you're, you know, a little more successful as an artist, you can start making more of that kind of art. But right now you need to make stuff that is going to sell. Mm. So you have to balance the commercial side of it with the more,
I mean, are you talking sort of political messaging or
a little bit like, yeah. And some of my art does have a kind of political message and some of the pieces that have a sort of a subtle message anyway, you could look at any piece of art that I've made, I hope, and it would just look like a beautiful scene.
Right.
Or you could read into it a little more. Often it's the title gives something away that will suggest a message. And, you know, for example, I did a piece with a polar bear in it recently. It's called Strange Times, and just sent it to Ontario. But there's a polar bear in a boat in a.
Am I looking at it? Right now? I'm seeing it there. Yeah, there it is. Yeah.
So you can see it up there. There's the polar bear in the boat in this choppy sea, So to me, I don't know if I want to say what it represents, but there is a pretty strong message in it, and the title is part of it. You know, we often talk about these COVID times as strange times. There's a kind of, I guess I'm explaining it. So
that
there's a bit of a hypocrisy. Lucky. There's a bit of a hypocrisy in that to me, in that for a long time now, we've been destroying the biosphere, the environment, and many species are have been facing a much more existential crisis than we are as a result of COVID for a long time. The polar bears, for example, you know, global warming or climate change is a threat to countless more living creatures than COVID is to us as humans. Yet. For COVID, we're willing to shut down the whole global economy.
Yeah,
and do things that when we talk about climate change or doing what we need to do to fight climate change, people would say, "Oh, we can't do that. You know, it would cost too much money to change over to environmentally friendly infrastructure or you know, basically, it's too expensive to fight climate change. We just have to keep." Focusing on growth and business as usual, yet we're not something that's so much more drastic for a much smaller existential crisis.
And that's and the polar bear in a boat is your. Oh, I've got to speak about this, but yeah. I don't want to don't want to step on too many toes. But yes. I really and so you do you feel that were you satisfied with the walking the edge there?
I got a lot of good responses, and I think a lot of people got it. People who responded on Facebook. But yeah, I think it's also it's a nice image. It's pretty to look at just in its own right, regardless of the message behind it.
I kind of made a decision, like, I'm not going to ever get political in my work, but I will allow my characters to have different political views. And that's neat because then you can have different opposing ones, because one of the ways to be a storyteller is you get off your, like, everyone's on a one track, if they have any track at all, they have like one way of looking at things. They sort of, you know, they collect information to sort of fortify the walls around the side of their little track, and they dig it deeper, and they're just in it for the long haul. And well, that's great. You can get some really good speeches out of that. But if you're going to tell a robust story, you've got different types of people. So if to do it responsibly, well, what's her point of view? What's the villain's point of view? And so I end up trying to understand different ways of approaching and learn all the arguments for many different types of question. And I can have a lot of fun with that. And where my own personal one comes down, people would probably, you know, be able to discern where it is, but I don't like to, you know, pump people over the head with it.
Yeah.
The closest I came was I did one about masks, and that was actually Zeus's idea. He goes, "Mark, you should do a strip. Oh, it'd be so good." And he described it to me, and I could instantly see that, yeah, it has to happen. And it was just like one character trying to order lunch. And so the server's got a mask.
You saw this one.
Yeah. And it's just like, hur, 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 and they couldn't understand each other. And by the end, it was just mumbles. Yeah. And I thought that was hilarious. And I showed it to a friend of mine who runs a cafe. And I've never heard her laugh out loud. She goes, that's exactly what it's like. That's hilarious, you know. And so I'll have fun with stuff. I want to, you know.
So what was that saying, that particular?
All I was comment? Saying is like, this is just, look, I mean, I don't want to say if it's right or wrong. I have my opinions on that. But this is what we're all experiencing. And anyone, doesn't matter what side of the question you're on, can look at it and go, yep, I lived through that.
And we should laugh about it.
You know, because there's so much grim, grim stuff. I mean, like, and it's, some of it's really, I feel like we're at a point in history now where I think media might start getting really bright. Like, you know, during the
I hope so.
The Great Depression, you had like Fred and Ginger dancing movies, and it was just people just wanted an escape from the grim realities. And so these incredibly fun productions sort of came out. And I'm seeing a couple of them. There's this one that I just saw. It was called Emily in Paris.
Yeah.
And it's about a young, impossibly well-attired, pretty girl, like, you know, going to Paris and having this sort of like crazy. It was ridiculous and bright and happy and positive.
I thought about watching that the other day. Is that you recommend it? Do you?
Absolutely. If you, it's wonderful escapism. It's very humane, and it's a absolute 180 degree contrast with things like Game of Thrones and you know, The Expanse and these brilliantly well made The Boys, like these dark, awful things that make you kind of feel sick after. You know, that was really good. I feel like I have to go crawl in a corner.
Yeah, I'm not sure how I feel about that stuff, because I feel like we have as an artist personally anyway, I feel like I have a moral obligation, and I kind of feel like everyone has this moral obligation to tell stories that are going to make the world a better place.
Yes,
and you know, there's a self-fulfilling prophecy at play here, like I was talking about before. You know, the more we're creating the world that we live in through the stories that we tell, and if we tell positive stories, if we're optimistic, then we're going to be contributing to making the world a better place. And if we tell pessimistic stories, which lots of people do, you know, there's so many apocalyptic stories out there now, which I feel like it's morally wrong to be putting that kind of stuff out there, because people are just going to lose hope if they watch that stuff.
Isn't that interesting? Because I've heard, as you were saying this, I'm going, oh, which way is he going to go on this? That's the way I go.
Right.
Because one way is like, if you just tell dreamy, happy things, then you're just sleepwalking into oblivion, and it's irresponsible. You have to be miserable all the time, you know, otherwise.
Obviously, it's important to point out problems in society, but always temper that with hope. If you can't have an element of hope to whatever your message is, then just don't say anything. Mm-hmm. You're better off just not. I mean, I suppose there are times where you have to point out atrocities that are happening, and it's there might be nothing hopeful about it. But when you're telling a story as an artist, I think it's important to be pointing at what needs to be done to make the world a better place, not just pointing at how awful the world is, you know, because of this one problem.
We're gonna do one thing here. I'm gonna move this around so that I can see your face.
Okay.
Arrange it so that we're making eye contact. That's good. And I mean, this is interesting. Like, your process now involves listening to like the radio, I guess, or listening to podcasts while you're working, which means automatically you are plugged in. Like, what are you listening to? Sort of like
I don't always do that. I often will just listen to music and often silence.
Okay.
And what I also like to do if it's a nice day is just go outside.
Yeah.
Sit at the picnic table in sand.
That's nice too. Yeah. Well, that's
listen to the birds.
It sounds like you're balanced. That's good. But I mean, I have a fascination with the world, and I'm very aware of a lot of extremely dark corners of reality, and I want to know what all the dark apocalyptic stuff is, and I find it fascinating.
Yeah.
But when I write, I'm not bringing that stuff. Like, that will inform, it gives you so much information that you can tell a very realistic, happy story. Because I know where everything is.
Yeah.
And once you know where everything is, you're not making mistakes, because if someone is blind to stuff, then they can't tell even a happy story correctly because they get things wrong, if that makes any sense. But yeah, I find my work, even when I'm writing dark stuff, it's funny. It's upbeat. People are cracking jokes. You're going to come away from it feeling better about the world. And when you have that sort of hope, sort of, burn in your belly, you're going to be able to face your day more easily. You know, you can power through a lot of miserable stuff if you feel confident and if you feel happy. Like, I actually, even with all the crazy things going on, I was like, I'm extremely hopeful for the future. I think there's a lot of difficult stuff that we're going to have to move through.
But yeah.
I think we're going to be, there's a lot of great stuff.
Climate change is a pretty big one, right? That's, it's hard to see the light at the end of the tunnel with that one, because for so long we've been destroying the planet, and there probably are a lot of species that are going to continue to go extinct because of what we're doing. However, it sounds a little selfish, but for us as humans, I think it's maybe putting the environmental stuff aside a little bit. But if you look at our trajectory, if you look at how much better the world has been progressively getting since the dawn of civilization, it's almost irrational to think that suddenly everything's going to fall apart and things are going to get worse, when if it's only ever gotten better. You know, there's like, I do a lot of, Steven Pinker?
Yes.
He wrote Enlightenment Now, and it basically,
I have one of his books. I haven't read the darn thing yet.
he's a good writer. He's a good philosopher. He's very optimistic. And so this book, Enlightenment Now, basically just shows all the ways in which the world has gotten better and is continuing to get better. And then he'll juxtapose that with all these, the media and these widespread beliefs that, the world is getting worse. So he's pointing at the reality despite the, all the pessimism that exists in the world, and his thesis is that the world's it's irrational to think that the world's going to suddenly stop getting better, or to not see that it has been getting better, and to not be hopeful, to not be optimistic.
I just came across an interesting study on pollution, and there was outcry about the U.S. withdrew from, was it the Kyoto Climate Accords? Yeah. And, this one researcher was just like, yeah, but look, the actual pollution levels continue to drop because as new technologies come along, pollution's inefficient. You don't make as much money by being dirty.
Yeah.
And so with the more a technological industrial society refines itself, the cleaner. I mean, look at Elon Musk. Guy's making, we're all going to be driving electric cars in 10 years. Yeah. And I know there's arguments for and against that, but I'm going, come on, electric's pretty damn cool, And if you look at the nations that are still part of the Kyoto Agreement, they haven't gotten as clean as the United States. And I know there is a political bias there. I didn't have the time to sort of explore it, but on the whole, being excited about making electric cars, for instance, is a, it seems like a good step away from, when I was a kid, we had, acid rain was a problem, and there were dead lakes. Those lakes are alive again, and that's just continual. We have, two steps forward, one step back. It's not an easy process, but the process seems to have a continual bend towards a very bright outcome.
Yeah.
That's what I see.
Of course there are hurdles. That's right. It's a learning process, but we are learning. Humans want to survive and we'll do what we have to do to survive. So, soon that's going to mean that we have to, increasingly that means that we have to change, what we do to the environment, because it can't take much.
One of my favorites. I'm a tech nerd as well. Do you know what a lifter reactor is?
No.
Okay, so it's liquid. Liquid fluoride thorium reactor. So basically, it's a type of nuclear reactor, mm-hmm. but it doesn't burn uranium. It burns thorium, and thorium is an extremely common element.
Yeah.
And one of the things that's neat about it is that it. It's a very clean reaction. Like basically, you turn thorium into the next, you make it fizz. Fissile.
Are you talking about nuclear fusion as opposed to nuclear fission?
It's nuclear fission. It's nuclear fission still. Right.
So that is really exciting. If we could figure out that technology, I think it already is being used, right?
No, you have heard of it. Then.
Yeah.
The Chinese are pursuing it. The thing is, it's like when I first heard about it 5 or 10 years ago, there was just a couple of physicists going, we had working designs and we stopped using them every now and then you look in on it and it's like now there's a lot of very serious people with a lot of money going, mm-hmm. yes, make it happen.
So when we get that, we can create hydrogen, right? We can use nuclear fusion to make as much hydrogen as we want to power cars and airplanes and everything else. And I know there's some risks associated with that, but
work that way.
The
promise of clean, cheap energy was subverted because the uranium reactors were like, it's kind of like buying an inkjet printer. You buy the printer, but they charge you through the nose for those little cartridges. Yeah. So like a little uranium tablet that goes into one of those reactors. It's the most expensive substance on the planet, and you're burning it, and you're only burning like 2% of it before it's waste material, and that's where the money comes from. And so we're sort of stuck on these filthy, dangerous nuclear reactors, and hopefully. The thorium approach won't be subverted. Anyway, there's enough interest in it.
So what's preventing us from figuring, what's the stumbling block? What's the...
Oh, okay. The engineering, they're just engineering problems. One is that liquid salts or liquid, fluoride are very, very corrosive. And so it's difficult to sort of keep a system going without it sort of eating itself. It can be done, but that's one of the challenges. Another challenge is... That's a pretty big challenge right there. But basically, it's like it's you have to figure out the design you're going to use. And there's lots of different designs. Mm-hmm. But then it just takes lots and lots and lots of money and lots of time and lots of engineering smarts. But the thing is, that is being, it's being developed.
Yeah.
And
you have to hope that as AI becomes more of a thing too. It's the early days of artificial intelligence, but that should be able to help us solve those sort of problems too in the near future, which is something I'm super excited about AI.
Really?
I don't know if we need to get into that.
I'm fascinated by AI. I'm the guy. I don't believe in it. I do believe, but I don't think. I think we're not going to see a Terminator kind of future.
Oh no, definitely not.
And I don't think we're going to see like Blade Runner, where you can't tell the difference between a person and a fake AI.
I think so either.
Maybe, yep. I don't know, man. Maybe I think we will probably see AI in battlefields and that sort of thing, and that's unfortunate. Yeah. But
maybe in the near future we will. But hopefully, humans will continue to get better at cooperating, and we're increasingly, because of things like the internet, especially, we're seeing our identity is changing. The way that we see ourselves as humans is changing, and we're coming to appreciate how interconnected we are, and we're seeing ourselves much more as a member of a species now. With the advent of the internet, the world's become so much more global. We have access to we can talk to people on the other side of the world, people from all different cultures, and we think of ourselves now, I think, much more as a global as global individuals, as part of a global community. And I think that's going to continue
There's a choice to be made, because it can go dark or it can go light, you know?
Yeah.
And we've seen the dark, like when people are using fear and intimidation and, you know, like the internet, it can be used to control people. We can see, like, you know, Twitter's a rage machine, you know?
Yeah.
I'm not on Twitter, but I'm on Facebook, and I don't use that. That's kind of corrupted as well. But you know what I do like? I like to be able to check, you know, send a message to my friends, and I like to be able to sort of share, you know, hey, I just drew this thing and put that out there. And if you use it in that particular way, you're sort of, you're engaging a different subjective series of experiences. And so I wouldn't say your reality changes, but your experience of reality changes, and you have some control over that.
Yeah.
But I mean,
it's true. It could go dark or light, that could bring us back to that point that we were making earlier about how it's important to see the light and to be optimistic, because, you know, how we feel about the world, what we believe might happen in the future, it plays a part in shaping the future.
Absolutely. Yes, absolutely. I believe in diverging timelines. I think you can, if you focus a whole lot on one particular type of experience, well, that experience may be at a certain point exclusive from another type, which are both possible, but you can only have one. And I think the universe will actually allow you to experience both, but you gotta pick, right?
Yeah.
And I think that sort of thing is happening all the time. I'm into science as well.
Yeah.
But I mean, here's one. I mean, oh, you know, AI, that'll be great. Well, what happens when an AI can see a really nice picture of Nova Scotia and then, you know, draw a nice sketch and then carve it into little pieces of wood and paint it better than you?
I know.
Does that ever, you know, occur to
sure.
you?
Sure. Sure. Yeah. I mean, I think that right now that's not a problem. People, I think, appreciate that what I do is it's made by a human.
Yeah.
You know, if someone, if an AI was going to do something similar to what I do, I don't think people would value it as much knowing that a computer had made it. You know, I think for a long time, people are going to continue to appreciate things that are made by hand, by humans. But I mean, I hesitate to go here because it's a bit of a rabbit hole. But have you by any chance read Homo Deus by Yuval Noah Harari? He also wrote Sapiens, A Brief History of Humankind.
No.
It's a big blockbuster history book.
Tell me about it.
Well, he writes about his vision of the future, and there's some really compelling stuff in this book. I highly recommend reading Homo Deus. But he talks a lot about artificial intelligence and how we're already using it. You know, to fly planes, we use it every time we Google something. But as artificial intelligence becomes more sophisticated and better at helping us to make decisions, and he has kind of a dark, almost a little bit pessimistic view of the future, I think, in that he thinks that there's this kind of threat where because of artificial intelligence and social media and what have you being used to watch people, that could be used by some kind of
it's being used now. I mean, they're trying to throw elections based on algorithms.
It is
you know,
being like, that's right, and it's so that's being manipulated by people for you know, bad reasons.
It's not,
you know,
Skynet. It's not self-aware and it got its own little game plan. Right now, it's being used as a tool. Right.
That's right. But artificial intelligence. The thing is, his argument is that as it gets better, as it gets to know us as individuals better, but through watching us throughout our lives, it will come to the point pretty soon, he thinks, where this artificial intelligence will know us better than we know ourselves, and can therefore make decisions for us better than we can make decisions for ourselves, such as, you know, who to marry, what sort of job to take, you know, like basically help us to live our lives and by making all of our decisions for us better than we can, because a computer is if it's just about processing data, and then it's something that a computer can do way better than
a human. Well, it's already at a point now where, like, you know, Google knows when, the AI that's the internet or portions of it, they know when you're going to take your next shit. They know before you know the meals that you're going to choose. Like, yeah. And they're crazy good at predicting this stuff just because they have such a huge data set and the averages come down. They know your patterns.
They're exponentially, they're getting better. Those algorithms are becoming more sophisticated. And so I kind of agree that in the near future, computers or artificial intelligence or whatever you want to call it, it is going to know us better than we know ourselves, especially because humans don't know themselves very well. You know, most people do not have a lot of self-awareness.
I consider it my sacred duty to not be easily or to break away from mechanical behavior, because the mechanical stuff, that's what's predictable because it's a machine, it's mechanic. But when you have a soul involved, you can go, oh, I can see the mechanics and I get to pick whether I stay on that ride or if I let spirit direct me to the next choice.
Yeah.
And I think, you try and figure out percentages, like what percentage of you is awake and able to function in that category. And I think it's really small. I think it's like, maybe 5%, and that's people who work at it, I catch myself going, I want a hamburger. Why? Oh, I saw a billboard for a hamburger. Darn it. Well, I know but I really want one. Now you're great. I'm part of the machine, as opposed to.
We're all part of the machine though, right? That's the thing is, we think, and that's another one of the great points that Hori and a lot of other philosophers have made, but that's that he talks about the illusion of free will. Mm. That we think that we have free will, but really every decision that we made is based on social conditioning and genetics and all these things that are out of our control. And that's another argument.
There's been these questions that bother us find their way into storytelling. And there's been a number of productions. I mean, there was, they redid Westworld. Did you ever see any of those?
I watched a couple of them, yeah.
They're violent and horrifying and cynical and extremely well made. And I was like, oh, fine, I'll watch the darn thing, even though I know it's actually hurting me. I'm getting closer to cancer by watching this awful show. But what it's exploring is interesting. And it's really neat because sometimes I'll watch something, the creators, I actually fundamentally disagree with their conclusions.
Yeah.
And so I might watch it and go, okay, it's like they're giving me one side of an argument and they're trying to, it's their version of a polar bear in a ship, except I disagree, And the one with Westworld was neat because he came to the end, they actually talked about it. Said, there is free will. It's just really fucking hard, And I thought that was interesting.
How do you mean?
How
did they mean?
Well, what they set up. Their story, their big bad villain was that you realize they were collecting data. They were trying to create massive data samples by watching humans interact with machines, and with those data samples, they were able to take the algorithmic science that they learned from that and map it across the globe. So everyone with a cell phone, everyone with an implant, they knew the behavior of every single person on the planet, and they could direct that behavior because they could create influences. They had a 100% control of the entire human population.
Who's they?
They being, these two crazy brothers had built a big, powerful computer and told the computer, control humanity because we're going to kill ourselves. And the computer said, fine, it's like one of Captain Kirk's Star Trek computers. Like, you have to let us have free will. So this computer was controlling everything, and that was what the war was about. And just discovering that that was going on brought you into the second or third season, or however much work they did. And there was a war. Do we turn it off? Do we keep it on? And whatever. That was just story mechanics. But through it was this question, like, if people are that easily understood and controlled and that mechanical, then what are we? Do we have free will? And they answered that question. Well, some people were just incorrigible. They just couldn't be controlled. And so they went in and they pulled them out and put them in insane asylums, and they contained them.
Yeah.
And that's ugly and awful.
Yeah.
And one of the machines, it was a robot who'd really learned, I don't think that's not nice. I'm going to fight against that. And so you had this interesting war, but that was the conclusion, was that humanity has no free will, except it does. It's just you have to fight for it.
Okay.
You've got, and that makes a lot. I mean, it's like an addiction. You know, like say you're a smoker, and you know you don't want to. You know it's not good for you, but you just have all these chemical compulsions to push you in that direction. You always have a choice to stop, but it's really, really hard. And I think a lot of life is like that.
Yeah.
And anyway, so as an artist, I think I want to be aware of those systems. And I think being an artist allows you to sort of look at things and make images and sort of study them more up close. And you understand the human condition a little bit better. And maybe that's a rung towards a little bit better grasp of actual free will.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's me babbling about that.
No, I think that sounds right. You know, that's what I guess that's as close as I guess I do believe in free will and in that, you know, when you're being creative, when you're in that creative state, you are and you're aware and you're exploring and trying different things out. That how could that not be? You can call it what you like, but to me, that's what free will is that being in that. Exercising that ability to be creative, to explore.
Here's an interesting question. So an image comes to you, I see a fox, or I see, you know, a beautiful seascape, and it's exciting, and it's making my heart rush, and I have to get it onto paper. Where did that come from? Are you connecting to something outside of the material? Is that a spiritual experience, or is that conditioned by, like, how does that... We don't know. I think maybe you learn by doing it, by engaging with it. Mm-hmm. But what are your thoughts on that? Like, where does your muse live?
Well, I mean, it's nature. You know, it's I see something outside of me that that speaks to me, or it could be something that just pops into my head, like the fox. Mm.
That just pops into your head, though. Yeah. That's the question. You know, like it's.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, I guess it's all connected, so it's hard to say if it's outside or inside or what. It's just is.
I think one of the definitions of what is an artist is questioning that impulse, you know, it's or understanding where it's coming from. Because sometimes this bothered me. I'm telling a story and I'm affecting lots of young readers and I'm going, whoa, what am I saying here? I mean, yeah, this is fascinating to me, but I'm telling a story that, is this a good message?
Yeah.
You know, it seemed like a good one, but I better pull back and do some research. I better read my Steven Pinker and figure out what am I doing to my readers? That really bothers, it still does. It bothered me a lot and I still spend a lot of time going, what am I saying?
Yeah.
And I think when you're examining your own efforts from that perspective, I'm not going to say that makes you an artist. I don't know what that makes you. It makes you more responsible or more self-aware.
But then, at the same time, of course, you want to, you don't want to be Pollyanna-ish. You don't want to be seen as just having rose-colored glasses on or whatever, and not, you know, then you're not really saying anything. You're not using your art to convey any message at all, right? If it's all just...
I had a story about it was a villain, and she was this dark sorceress, and she was essentially a psychopath. She was a horrible, dangerous, awful, selfish person. And her story arc was a redemption arc. By the end of it, she changed. And through this, I was saying, it's okay to, you can love a person like this. And if you love them enough and if you, you know, provide enough forgiveness, then you can help them heal. And that could be an extraordinarily destructive message because psychopaths can't change. Like a genetic psychopath, if you meet one, it doesn't matter how much, they just want you to feed that because that's how they grow strong. And so what message did I just give to a bunch of kids? Like if they find themselves in an abusive relationship, for instance. But
in most situations, that's a good message for them to, you know, it's good for us to try to help one another. And most people aren't psychopaths, so
this is the thing. It's like I came out of that and I ended up the way I solved it, because I'd already committed like years of narrative up to this point. And I said, okay, this hit me. And I'm like, oh, am I hurting or harming the world?
Yeah.
So I said, well, let's make it a discussion with the characters. And so I was able to sort of address that in a way that hopefully if you read through the whole thing, you're able to understand that there is a choice to make.
Yeah. So you're a writer of, you write novels as well.
Well, the comics and the narratives go together. Like, right.
But you said this one in particular, where you said you invested years into thinking about it. Is that a comic or is it,
it was a comic.
Like a longer?
It's, when I began, there was no internet. And I put out a comic book every 2 months, like a 20-page story. And that six times a year for enough years to make 50 comics, which is a big stack of graphic novels. And it was all one continuous narrative. And it was set in this sort of fantasy world. It was like, I describe it as like Harry Potter meets Lord of the Rings. So it's, I began before Harry Potter. that was one of the big books that I'm working. I'm still, knocking out pages here and there. I've got a couple more on my drafting board that continues. It's well over 1,000 pages long for a comic book series.
Wow.
Are you a writer as well?
Yep.
Okay.
That was my, I said if I could have chosen to be a visual artist, that's what I would have chosen. But the truth is that I'm not sure now. I quite enjoy I love making visual art now, so that I think that's something that I will always do. But my first passion, creative passion in life, was writing.
Really?
And
it doesn't surprise me the way you speak and the way you present yourself. Yeah.
I spent many years trying to. I think as a lot of writers, their first novels will be about their own experiences. It's a cathartic thing or whatever they need to. They need to write about their childhoods. So I did that.
That's interesting.
And spent years kind of trying to get away from that and then coming back to it and not being able to let go of this one story that I had written. And so when I went to New Zealand last time, I told you I did, I studied creative writing. So I did a postgraduate diploma in creative writing.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And it was awesome. I learned more in that 1 year than I had learned in the 20 years previous on my own. And my teacher, she encouraged me not to give up on this story, which is what I took into the program to refine and hopefully finish it and be done with it.
Yeah.
And, so I'm still working on that and it's changed a lot. It's no longer about me. Uh-huh. It's similar storyline, I'm passionate about writing and I've enjoyed I usually enjoy writing, but sometimes I just do it because I have to. One of the things that Mandy, my teacher, said to me is I can't remember who said it. It's a quote by some famous writer who said that if you don't have to write, then for God's sake, don't write. If you do have to write, then you're a writer.
Yeah.
So it's just something that some of us have in us. We have to do. And certainly I have that with this story that I'm trying to write now.
Tell me a little bit about it, if you don't mind.
Okay. It's set between Canada and Sierra Leone, West Africa.
Okay.
Mostly in Sierra Leone during the Sierra Leone Civil War. So the 1990s.
Okay.
Early 1990s. And it all takes place in, it'd be less than a year, about 6 months. So that's when I was 13, my family went to Sierra Leone during the Sierra Leone Civil War, and my dad is a surgeon, so he was volunteering in this remote area of the country, and so it's loosely based on a lot of my experiences there, but the protagonist is a female,
okay,
and so I've given the story this character arc, which it in real life it didn't have, because it's one of the things I learned through studying writing is that you really need that. You can't just write about reality as it is, and readers want a character arc.
It's kind of like you can take a photograph and draw from it, or you can paint the dream version, and the dream version is more powerful.
Yes, much more powerful. And so it's great. I've been able to say explore some themes that I that I wanted to explore through my writing by giving it this story arc, this character arc. And so now, yeah, it's about I guess it's a story about privilege, mm-hmm. and coming to a light-skinned, rich person, coming to terms with their privilege.
Oh wow!
So I think it's pretty topical. You know, it's something that if I can get it finished soon,
in time,
it'll be marketable. Huh. And then I'm very excited to get started on my next story, which is it's going to be a futuristic story. So if you've heard of singularity,
sure,
have you? So it's a post singularity.
This is an AI singularity,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah. So maybe for people who are listening, sure, and don't know, singularity is where it's the point at which computers are supposed to will hypothetically become smarter than humans.
Okay.
So at this point, basically, artificial intelligence will explode because it will be able to start programming itself.
Right.
And then we see technology. Up to now, we've seen technology evolving or advancing at an exponential rate. But we're almost. The argument is, or the suggestion is, that we're almost at the knee of the curve where technology is about to just take off. And if we think that we don't understand, the world becomes so complicated, technology becomes so complicated that we don't understand half of how the way anything works now, just wait 20 years from now or 50 years from now, and like our minds are just gonna be blown by the technological advances which are happening. Without much human input, you know, we might give the artificial intelligence some direction, but it's going to be, as I said, doing its own thing and programming itself. So people are worried about most people are scared of this kind of future. They worry about artificial intelligence being evil. And so there are lots of kind of apocalyptic or dystopian stories that have been told about the post singularity, and I want to write one that is utopian. Hmm. So a sort of utopian take on the singularity and the merging of humans and technology.
Oh man, so you must be a fan of the Neuralink stuff. Really? See, I think that's
I understand the fears that people have of that. Mm. But I think it's inevitable. And man, there's a really good book called What Technology Wants by Kevin Kelly.
Okay.
He's one of the co-founders of Wired magazine, and okay. His thesis is that technology, or the technium, he calls it, is part of nature, and that it is subject to the natural forces of evolution, just like everything else. And that, we see ourselves. Humans see themselves as being outside of nature. Hmm. We certainly see almost all of us see technology as being something that's separate from nature. But his argument is that it's not. It's part of nature, and it's all part of this natural evolution towards.
I can see that. I mean, it's like a flower comes out of the dirt.
Yeah.
And you think, well, that flower, it's separate from. No, it's made of the same stuff. It's just it took a lot of complex navigation through complicated little, you know, systems that created new systems that create. Now you've got petals.
Yeah.
And human technology is kind of just an extension of the dirt.
Yeah.
You know, coming up through us and finding ever increasing.
And technology is already a part of humans. You know, we have merged with our technology in lots of ways now that without it we wouldn't be able to. We wouldn't be who we are. You know, without our computers, without our books, you know, with language even as a technology. And language is perhaps the biggest, most defining technology. It's the thing that Yuval Harari, that guy I was talking about, who wrote Sapiens, he he believes, I mean, he's not alone in believing this, but one of the things he points out is that it's probably language that saved humans, that allowed us to thrive while the other various species, human species, went extinct. It's because it was through language and storytelling, we were able to create these intersubjective realities and cooperate on a much grander scale than Neanderthals or other species could do, because they didn't have this sophisticated language and stories that they would tell, like creation stories that they would tell each other, so that they shared this reality and they could, you know, they were able to build cities and they were religions and countries, and I mean, so anyway, I digressed a lot.
Please,
there.
This is the good part.
So this story that I'm writing, it's about this after humans have merged with technology, I don't want to give too much away,
yeah.
But it's another thing that's really important to me, at the risk of sounding flaky, is mysticism. I
was going to ask. Yeah,
I had a pretty profound mystical experience as a young man, and I think that's shaped a lot of who I am and how I see the world. And in my writing now, that's the number one thing that I want to kind of get across. And I think it's the main reason I started writing, actually, is I wanted to try to understand this experience that I had.
Do you mind talking about it?
No, I can. I think most people have had mystical experiences.
Yeah, yeah. If we can talk to people long enough.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, basically any time you look at a sunset or the moon or the ocean and you forget yourself and you feel completely connected with everything, and you see that everything is just connected and beautiful and perfect, that's this sort of transpersonal state or mystical state, where there's no separation between myself and anyone else. Everything is connected. I mean, that's essentially what mysticism is, mm-hmm. as I understand it, and I've done a bit of reading, but I think that my hope is that as we merge with technology, and I'm hesitant to go here because I know it could sound crazy to a lot of people, but
I've made peace with me being crazy.
I guess I should too.
Yeah, you're an artist. You're allowed.
I'm an artist.
Yeah, you're my prerogative. Allowed. This is actually that's something right. that's expected of you. You're supposed to experience.
Well, I'm just playing the part.
Yeah.
So as we merge with our technology and it makes more of our decisions for us and takes care of us more, it will free us up, and in that it will allow us to not have to struggle so much to make decisions. We spend so much of our lives
surviving,
just surviving. That's right. Which is why I think we can't stay in this mystical state, is because we're competing with each other. We have to make all these decisions, and we're full of doubt. I spend probably half my time questioning decisions that I've made or that I'm trying to make. You know, while I'm trying to make a decision, I could be doubting the decision that I'm making. And well, I think that
what was the mystical experience that you had that are you getting to that, or are you?
I'm not. I kind of went away from that, but I could go back to it
because I can feel myself going. Okay. And okay. I know anyone watching this is like, is he going to ask him? And right. So I wanted to put the question out there. If you don't want to answer,
that's
fine.
No, that's okay.
Because it is a personal thing, right?
So I spent a lot of time, like I told you, in the woods as a kid, me and my dog. And
mystery starts at the edge of the woods, doesn't it? Yeah.
So that you, I think people have a lot of mystical experiences in nature, and just that feeling of connectedness. And when I was a young man and I started writing about my past, we have to go back a little further. So as a boy, I was very shy, very scared of other people, very worried about what other people thought of me, and then as a young man, when I started writing about my past and revealing all my fears and faults, I found it extremely freeing, like very, very liberating. And I realized that if I could completely overcome my fear of judgment and maybe like fear in general, that's the closest that I could be to becoming, you know, being my true self and being really free. Mm. So I tried to stop caring. I did stop caring about my external appearance. I put a sheet over the mirror in the bathroom.
Oh, wow.
I shaved my head.
How old are you?
I was 20 at the time.
Okay.
And I felt freer than I've ever felt in my life. And I felt this, and I had this sort of, I was in this mystical state where when I looked at other people, I would look them in the eyes, and it was like I'd be looking at myself. You know, I saw no separation between myself and anyone else. And yeah, I stopped judging people. I stopped judging myself. I was just completely open, and I felt just love and joy all the time. But I couldn't stay in that place, you know, because I live in a world where you have to, you know, work, and like I said, and compete, and now I have to look after kids. And so that's the mystical state. And my story, it's called Integration, the one that I hope to get work on more soon when I finish the other one, is basically about how technology will allow us to stay in that mystical state by doing all that stuff for us that prevents us from staying in that state, like by making those decisions, by erasing doubt from our minds, because we can sort of relinquish control to the system, or
let the system take care of stacking the boxes. You know,
yeah. But then we'll see ourselves as part of the system, you know, and that's kind of what that mystical state is too, is that seeing yourself as not separate from the whole, but
that's interesting.
It's all connected.
See, I think that happens, like that's already going on, like right now. See, the way my parents were, my dad was an engineer, my grandfather was an engineer, and I grew up with this kind of background, and I'm fascinated by mystical, the spirit realm.
Yeah.
And it wasn't even something that I took seriously until, you know, I began bumping, locking horns with it and realizing, oh my goodness, there's a lot going on out there. But I wanted to grapple with it in a mechanistic kind of, well, it's got to have rules. How does it work? You know, and I found that a very, very productive way of exploring it. And I think that we are in contact right now, and Zeus is part of the conversation, and 90% of it's all happening up above or wherever it is, and our conscious selves aren't aware of it. And but the conscious selves are hyper important, because that's the experience collection. And being ignorant of past lives or the larger reality around us.
Can we access that stuff, do you think? Or?
Oh, yes.
But we're distracted?
I think it's important to not be aware of all the stuff we know, so that we can make real mistakes and make honest things and be terrified and be in love and sort of go, oh, I want to try this thing because I don't know, because, well, you've got this huge, vast puzzle that you're building. There's a lot more to make. But to get to this piece, you have to forget about all these other ones, because why would you do that piece if you know, how do I describe this? There's a lot of value in breaking your leg, but to break your leg, you have to forget how to, you know, cross the street safely, you know, but breaking your leg, like, man, you really want that experience, and you've somehow avoided it because it's painful and it's dumb and you're going to feel stupid. But once you've done it and you've healed from it, you're going to grow as a soul. And so I think a lot of our experience is lined up like that. I mean, I went through this one period where I was reading all kinds of books about past life regression. Okay. And I came across one. And I was like, oh, this is interesting. I had a bunch of exercises, and I was sort of just kind of going through the exercises, and I hit this certain point because I really wanted to know. And I felt like I hit this sort of interesting barrier. I was like, oh, I'm really close. And then suddenly it wasn't a voice. It was kind of like, I don't know, a larger intelligence sort of connected and was like, are you sure? Because you can.
Yeah.
Are you sure? And I was like, ah, it says, and suddenly the thought of like, well, if you've known all these, all the souls that you run into, all the people that you run into before over and over and over again in different configurations, what if, you know, like, what if the people who are your parents were your brothers and sisters or lovers? Or I was like, oh, that's weird. And I basically realized I can't deal with that. I don't want to deal with that. That will actually prevent me from living my current life honestly and fully. And so, shut that. And it was, and it laughed and it was like, ha, ha, and off it went, you know? And so then I was left, okay, put the book back on the shelf. Right. Never touched
it
again.
So was that, so you, that you see that as being something outside of yourself, that voice, or was it,
I think it might have been me, or it might have been, I don't know what it was. It might have just, like, the way I look at that is that we're tiny little receptors that are part of a much larger intelligence. Like, one thing I heard, and it kind of, I don't know if it's true or not, is that, oh, a soul is actually a much larger thing than one little body can handle. So it's probably, you're probably a piece of, you know, there's 20 versions of Will Cooper out there, all experiencing one piece of the, all working on this one large, you know, algorithm, I guess.
Yeah.
And anyway, so I see it as, and when I read about sort of UFO stuff and where sort of super advanced tech, you know, civilizations theoretically are, there is a melding. They, you know, they understand souls, but they can use machines to sort of extract and manipulate and program. And you're kind of going, that's creepy. But what you're saying, well, technology is, it's not separate from us.
Yeah.
It's just like, you know,
and I don't understand. I'm not super knowledgeable when it comes to technology, but one of the things that Harari talks about, and you know, Ray Kurzweil, have you heard of Ray Kurzweil?
No.
Well, lots of futurists, and what we'll talk about is that everything, and I don't know if this is true, but they say that everything can be broken down to algorithms. Everything is basically energy interacting, information interacting, and it's all, if we could, I mean, if everything is algorithms, then essentially, I'm not sure.
We've lost ourselves. Yeah,
I've lost it. Myself.
Those rabbit holes bounce.
But
at the bottom. Yeah.
But that's the. That is certainly one of his arguments that he makes, is that if everything is can be understood as an algorithm, then basically we're one big computer system. And I'm not sure why I just said that, because it doesn't really, it's a bit of a non sequitur when you were talking about something pretty different.
No, I think you're talking about the same thing, actually. The one big computer system. Well, how is that different from, like, if it's super advanced and it connects everything and all experiences are part of it and it's like aware of things in non-linear time and it just gets more and more, how is that different from God?
Well, like, how I don't think it is,
you know.
Yeah, I think, yeah, I don't think there is any difference. I don't particularly I like the word God, because
it has lots
of religious connotations.
Yeah. And I think religion's been, I know.
But also, and as soon as you say the word God, I think it becomes something that, to me anyway, it's not, you know, because like I told you, I have this sort of, this monistic worldview, from this mystical experience that I had, I guess, where, I think everything is, and I think you do too, interconnected, right? So as soon as you give it a name or imagine it as something out there,
it's no longer infinite.
That's not what it is. That's right. It's we are it. You are it. Everything is it.
You still need a word for it. It's like, well, you know, infinity
then,
means infinity.
Yeah. And there are better words, like even universe. You know, universe, if you look at the definition of universe, it's all existing things.
Yes.
That's great. I like that.
I like that one too. But I actually like to use the word God, because it makes me awkward and I don't like it. It's like, because I know the program.
It's a good way to start a conversation with someone, because everyone has a different idea about what God is. So you can challenge people, I guess, in their worldviews by talking about God. But
sorry, my, you know, the way I use the word God, if you get down to definitions and brass tacks, it's basically, it's the universe. Right. The universe is self-aware, yeah, and we're its awareness.
But for most people, that's not what God is.
No. God is an old man in the sky with a beard, yeah, you know?
It's, or other, all kinds of other versions.
There's all of, kinds, yeah, right? But I like that one because I can logically get there. I can understand it. I can tell I can make a narrative that doesn't sort of, none of it's provable, but experientially, I mean, you can't prove that your particular
experience.
You can't
prove anything, right? You can only disprove things.
But you can prove, but to yourself, every step that you make, no, that's a reasonable step. Like to the point where you're going, I'm shaving my head and throwing a blanket over the, or a sheet over the mirror. That those steps made sense and it had tangible results that were positive and helped you make your next steps and brought you to where you are now. And that's a really, that's a nice complete, well, not a complete journey, but it's a valid journey. And you're telling me going, oh, cool, you know? And, I lost my thread. I got lost down that rabbit hole too. I don't know where I was going with that. What were we talking about like 5 seconds ago?
God?
Yeah, I guess it's easy to get lost.
The universe, everything being interconnected and, or what,
anyway, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. But here's the thing. Being a writer and saying, oh, I'm going to take on a big subject like AI and awareness, and the human race and how we fit together. I think these kinds of conversations are hyper important.
Like
When I was writing my stuff, I would always call up a best friend and say, hey, this is the latest thing. We'd hash things out and stuff would change.
I might have to talk to you again because I don't have many people who I can talk to about this futurism stuff. My wife, and my friends are tired of it. They're not interested in it. I think. Do you know Eric Kershaw?
No.
Okay. You remind me a lot of him. He's a teacher. He lives in Wolfville.
Okay.
Around our age, and he's the only guy I know who I can.
Writers need to know writers if they're going to be successful as writers.
Yeah.
Someone told me that rule. I mean, I didn't know any other people in comics when I got in, but I did have luminaries that I was sort of following and I was in sort of, you know, letter writing contact with. But if you're going to be, you look at the great writers, they knew each other. They hung out with each other. They got drunk together. They go to the same cafes, you know, depending on what layer of history you're looking at
and philosophize together.
Yeah.
I love philosophy, by the way. That's what my major was at.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. In New Zealand. I started out in teacher's college. Mm-hmm. Because I thought I needed to do something practical, but I really didn't like it.
Uh-huh.
And I switched over to philosophy, and I loved that.
What was it about the teacher? What is teacher's college? What do they teach you in teacher's college?
How to teach, I guess. They teach you about, a lot of it's, they're teaching you the, about catering to the individual needs of the student, you know, the child, which is... trying to understand the different learning styles of different kids and I can accommodate that in the classroom. But
so like child psychology? Or?
Yeah, there's a lot of child psychology and child development and, lots of practical stuff for, I was doing early years. So I guess it's different for different types of teachers, but for early years teachers, they give you some strategies for teaching numeracy and literacy and...
Wow, I mean, it's all. It sounds like the sort of thing I'd be interested in, but as you're describing, I'm going, oh God, I'd hate that class.
I didn't like it. I liked the philosophical side of it. Like the philosophy of education was a great course, but the rest of it, what it came down to really is, I actually didn't mind the university part of it, being at teacher's college where it's lots of ideas and discussion. About what makes a good teacher and what children need and how they develop. And it's when I got to the classroom, when I had to do my teaching experience and I had 30 kids demanding my attention and my energy and the boys hanging off me wanting to play. And I just can't do that. I don't have that kind of energy. I'm not wired that way or whatever. And I barely have enough patience for my own 3 kids. Let alone,
maybe you should have gone for high school. I think some of the best teachers are the ones who come at it later in life. They've done a career.
I thought of that high school. And I did actually teach for a few years in New Zealand, but it was an international college.
Okay.
So it was university students. I was teaching in the diploma program, teaching environmental studies. And I did enjoy that, but it's not, it was a little bit, it's not art. You know, it's not what I really want to be doing with my life, which is
creating. I really enjoy being in classrooms.
Yeah.
But I also am really exhausted by it. Get to the end of a day of, okay, I'd go in and go, oh, I'm going to do a cartooning workshop, and I'm going to this one school, and I go to visit three different classrooms over the course of the day.
Yeah.
Or maybe two before lunch, two after lunch, and your day's over. I get to the end and I'm like dead on my feet.
Yeah. It's exhausting.
And I talk to these, how do you do this day after day?
It takes a special person.
You know,
some people are great at it, and I think a lot of people get energy from doing it too, but it's not me. I'd feel drained at the end of the day too. And I'd feel when I was standing in front of a class, like I was acting, like I had to put on a show and entertain. Yes. And I didn't like that. Sometimes it was fun, but on the whole, I found it exhausting.
I think smaller groups and different dynamics and different feng shui would make it a much better experience.
And if you were teaching something that you're really passionate about too, that would be different. Like if I'd been teaching philosophy with a small group of students and we could have just been, you know, discussing the big questions, then I would have loved it.
Yeah.
But I was teaching environmental studies to mostly unenthusiastic students who I had to, you know, push to get anything out of.
How old were they?
They were in their 20s.
Okay. Okay.
But it's an international college, right? So although there were native speaking New Zealanders at the college, there were about 10% of the college, 90% were students from other countries whose first language wasn't English. So a lot of it was teaching English too, which is the only way that I mean, I wouldn't have got the job otherwise, but I had a year experience teaching English in Korea.
Okay.
And
so you spent a fair bit of time in classrooms, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I did. I thought that was going to be my thing, but turns out I'm an artist instead, which I think
it's another way of teaching, actually.
You know? Yes, that's true.
I think it really is. It's you're basically taking something that you know and have experienced and see value in,
yep,
and you want to share it with people who can maybe see what you've seen and come away a little bit
bigger. Yeah, I like to look at it that way. You know? Sure.
Man, it's really interesting that you're also a writer. That's very, very cool. I hesitate to... Nah, okay. Have you run the idea of like illustrating, using, of course, your art?
Yeah. Problem with that.
Don't
is
do it,
it
man.
Takes
Don't
so
do it.
Long.
Exactly. You know,
and I wouldn't be able to sell that. I mean, I could, but it would be hard to sell an image that was made for a story, as something that someone might want to put on their wall, or maybe it wouldn't, but, I'd rather have the freedom to make something, a standalone image that, is for that purpose.
I mean, I guess actually my immediate thought was, no, don't do it. You got to keep them separate. It's okay because they just don't complement each other well enough to sort of really make you happy.
My wife wants me to do that. She wants me to, she keeps suggesting that I make a children's book or even just a series of images with different scenes around Nova Scotia and maybe.
Well, I've seen them. I've seen it happen. I mean, you know, kids book, pop it off the shelf and you immediately see the psychology. This woman was very, very good at making clay scenes. Like it would be she'd make like a back garden of a little English house and it was beautiful, all made out of little bits of clay that are differently colored. Yeah. And someone clearly saw it and said, you should do a children's book.
Yeah.
And this is the end result of that. Is it any good? It comes down to the story.
Yes.
I didn't read it. I was like, oh, this is nice.
Yeah.
It's almost like the convenient answer. But then I'm going, wait a sec, Mark. That's all I do.
Yeah.
I love drawing, but I've drawn thousands and thousands and thousands of pictures, and some of them are really, really good, and I never would have gotten to any of the really good ones if I wasn't compelled to draw the next picture because they have to tell a story.
It's part of a story, yeah.
But then again, you know, I can draw a picture in an hour. You go from an idea to a fully completed, gray-toned, nice, standalone panel.
Yeah.
You can't do that.
No, but you know, I think I might do a children's book at some point. I've written some manuscripts for environmentally themed children's stories.
I just got a great idea.
Oh, yeah?
Okay. Take some of the pictures that you have, because I feel like we exist in a time continuum, and that things work backwards and forwards. So you may have already written the story in images.
Possibly.
And all you have to do is go and find the tale and put it together.
But then it wouldn't work with a protagonist or a main character because I might have two paintings that have you know, a fox that looks similar in them, a story needs to have characters, right? Or at least a character.
Well, here's what, you know, Photoshop can do layers. You've got background, and then you can do a little cutout piece that would sort of sit on front of it.
I don't know if it would work, though, because...
I'm just throwing
the thing is, with my art, there's you see the shadows, where the cutout lines are, you see the shadow. I don't think I could...
I would literally make it in front. Like that's a background. And there's a person. There's interesting ways.
It's true.
And here's the thing, though. It's a problem to solve. You don't know the answer.
Yeah.
In finding the answer, you discover something unexpected.
It's not a bad idea. And I could cut it out in Photoshop, like cut out a fox or what have you, and superimpose it on a.
And even another, if I cast another image, a shadow on the thing,
even if it looks.
Don't pretend that it's not artwork.
Exactly.
I don't know. It's just the thing is,
it's a neat idea.
In struggling with the impossible and finding an answer, you've now brought. This was one interesting definition for what is the purpose of life? What does God want from us? And it is basically like, well, you've got an infinite Lego set. Go and make cool stuff that hasn't been done yet.
Yeah.
And so, well, it's all been done. Yeah. But
not in every conceivable way.
I mean, one way of looking at reality is that every conceivable combination has been built.
Yeah,
fair enough. And if time doesn't exist the way we think it does, it's you know, it's the all of reality, the entire universe. It's over in it begins and ends in a snap. It's all there. But I think where time comes in, like time, I think is an experience of us moving across space. It's like motion vector.
Yeah.
And it's the awareness, it's the consciousness experiencing those things that validates and creates them.
It creates the time too. It's our perception of time anyway.
And so the idea may be out there and maybe no consciousness has gotten there yet. And it's our job to explore it. Like if you don't, you're not honoring reality.
Yeah, that makes sense to me. Absolutely.
Anyway, yeah.
That's what we're meant to do. It's our purpose. But I wouldn't say that God gave it to us. I'd say
it's the universe. Maybe,
it's just our life even, you know, like what life wants us to do.
Or yes.
What we're meant to do. It's
it's the force. What does the force want you to do? It's like because I was a Star Wars kid when I was...
Our evolutionary imperative. You could
call it whatever you want. I like the word God just because it does sort of... I don't like to have negative... I think it's a knot that was tied into me.
Right.
And you described, I want to get rid of the little bits of fear and the little bits of self.
Yeah.
It shouldn't matter.
It's true. I agree. We should be free to use whatever language we want and not...
it's not a dirty word.
Yeah.
And yet it's been made dirty by...
Yeah.
Anyway, I haven't solved it yet. I don't understand. I like to use it every now and then just sort of see how it makes me twitch.
Yeah. You know, like... It's good. Stay open. I think that's important. That's a good point.
You know. How are we doing on time, Zeus? Man,
whoa,
that went quick.
How'd that happen?
Yeah. Do you want to think about wrapping it up? Or?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay. Well, man, it was so great. I didn't know what to expect, but I had no idea that I was going to get
I had no idea what to expect either. And I had a great conversation with you. So, it was really nice to meet you. I feel like you're a very interesting and nice guy who I'm now friends with.
That's great. And we're going to have you on again. And we should definitely stay in touch, especially if we want to talk writing. I'll give you my phone number and that sort of thing, too.
Sweet.
Anyway, thank you so much for joining us, everybody. I hope you hit like and subscribe. That is important. I've been, I've been schooled on that. You know, make sure that if you don't have a YouTube account, make one. It doesn't take too long. Hit the subscribe button. We got to get those numbers up and put this podcast out there. And join us again for another episode of From the Valley. Take care, guys. Love you all. Have a great day.